kindly not, my lord, travel through that path which disturbs the constitutional balance of separation of powers. The constitution has conferred that power on the highest constitutional functionary, and he has his own way of appointing. My lord, I cannot, my lord, give an example, otherwise I would have given an example. My lord, there are no rules or there are no acts of appointment. Your lordships as a collegium do take into consideration intangible facts which are not written down somewhere. That this, there was a case where
you understand what you're
doing. I'm understanding.
Unfortunately, you have not put in place, like in
Pakistan. Wisely so.
Pakistan, they have put in place.
But we don't follow Pakistan mostly. That's the wise thing we do. Look at the position they have reached. That non-trusting the executive, that but for an outside interference, they would not be able to discharge the constitutional function, is constitutionally impermissible. And second, again, my lord, a very onerous responsibility to make this submission. But please take this as a constitutional proposition, not, my lord, otherwise. To, my lord, presuppose that it is only when there is a presence of one of the organs of the state, namely the judiciary, that transparency, accountability, and all other good things can be achieved, will also be constitutionally, my lord, not a correct position. Lord, we have bureaucrats. Bureaucrats are doing amazing work. They are deciding policies of the nation. They are deciding what are the nation's national policies with other countries. My lord, there may be inefficient bureaucrats. There may be inefficient politicians. There may be corrupt bureaucrats. There may be corrupt politicians. But this is the position in every sphere of life. So mere presence of someone from one organ can only ensure transparency. Maybe, my lord, a fallacious fundamental foundation to make an argument on, which, my lord, my learned friend has, my lord, sought to make. Lord, that is, my lord, my second submission. My lord, therefore, the lordships may kindly not, my lord, travel through that path which disturbs the constitutional balance of separation of powers. Because that might, my lord, we have to tread very, very carefully.
Absolutely.
And my lord, it might, my lord, why enter into an area which might have a
very delicate, what you said, right? It has to be done, whatever has to be done, it has to be done with a lot of care.
Yes. Because, my lord, I, at the cost of repetition, say the independence of executive within the bounds of the constitution is equally sacrosanct.
That's in Article 50 also.
Yes.
The directive principle.
Yes.
There can't be two opinions about it.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
What we put to them also and what I put into you also, in 324.2, it says subject to the provisions of any law made in this behalf by the parliament, be made by the president. Our question is, where is that law as on today in place which permits you to proceed and process the name for appointment?
This I bow down. But not that presupposes my 53B argument is not accepted for the time being, my lord. I presumed it, and my lord, I go further. Because my first argument is that law is taking some the conferring power on somebody else other than president. In absence of that law, the president will have the power. Look, suppose sub-article 2 is read as my lords have, my lord, kind enough to, my lord, say, and there is no law. Then your lordships would make a suggestion to the parliament. No, there can't be a mandamus to the parliament, nor there can be an attempt to create, my lord, fill up that constitutional silence by way of judicial interpretation. Because we are dealing with Constitution of India, not a statute.
Would this solicitor then suggest that the court should not undertake the exercise of saying what should be the process, but can certainly nudge the executive to do something which is expected to be done under
24. Yes, yes, that certainly your lordships can do that. But that in absence of the law, this will be the law. Till you make the legislative enactment, will not be, my lord, constitutionally permissible.
All right.
Because we are dealing with a constitutional provision and not a statutory provision.
So we can now take from your statement that all appointments which are being made on the respective post of election commissioner or a chief election commissioner, they are randomly made on the basis of whatever the mechanism you consider to be appropriate. There is no law on the place.
Let me answer that, my lord. Let me answer.
So you said,
lauded question.
You said that we have not come out with any law with the law.
Lord, my answer is that it's an enabling provision, not a mandatory provision.
You could have said that, all right,
it's a enabling,
not mandatory, we have not followed it. Still, we have a mechanism in place, lord, which is impartial, let's say, unbiased.
Kindly appreciate, my lord. It's an enabling provision. In absence of any law, it's not as if appointments cannot be made. No, lord, this is something serious.
Yes.
Lord, the constitution has conferred that power on the highest constitutional functionary, and he has his own way of appointing. My lord, I cannot, my lord, give an example, otherwise I would have given an example. Lord, all constitutional positions in all three organs of the state, including judiciary, there are no rules or there are no acts of appointment. Your lordships as a collegium do take into consideration intangible facts which are not written down somewhere, that this would be the seniority, this would be the marks for judgment writing, mark for personality, mark for court behavior, etc. These are the intangible things. It is left to the wisdom of the people who are again constitutional functionaries. Here, President of India is the highest constitutional functionary.
You are not aware of. The attorney has given us a statement today, a written statement, and paragraph 6 was read over to us. You have a copy?
I have. Yes, I have read it.
It is in something different. What you say is different than what is paragraph 6 is different. Please read it for clarification for us. You have it, this attorney, please have it. Attorney, this was a supplementary submission of the Bihar Business of India.
Yes, sir, supplement. Today's submission.
No, because today so many submissions were made.
By convention.
This is para 6. Yes. By convention, it has been established.
Yes, yes, that's what I'm saying.
Have you read it?
The Honorable President, I have read, my lord. The Honorable President has his own mechanism of selecting in absence of the law. But in absence of the law, which is not a mandate of the Constitution, neither the appointment would be illegal or can be termed as random, to say the least. These are all constitutional appointments made by the President of India, on whom power is vested by the Constitution.
You've understood, Sarvajita. Nobody is suggesting that these appointments are illegal. And nobody has
randomly made.
What you're saying is something different. What you're saying is, over a period of time from 1990 onwards, the Government of India itself appointed committees, official reports, law commission reports, other committee reports.
Can be considered by the parliament.
So that's a question. That's the only question.
Certainly, my lord. Certainly. Now, my lord, I come to, my lord, some of the judgments, and, my lord, I conclude.
Yeah.
Lord, one more. Just
give us, kindly give us those citations so that, and the paragraphs. Which
no, no, I have quoted and highlighted. I'll read only highlighted part, not even quoted part.
Just, you don't have to read it. If you just give us a paragraph and we will...
Yes,
no, let me tell you, give me 5-10 minutes more.
We are telling you, we'll go through it. You don't have to, not as we will not go through
Lord, kindly, allow me for my satisfaction. Lord, kindly come to, first of all, page 16 of this. Lord, there is a new point.
Note, we'll see. We'll make a note of his written submission from Solicitor General. We'll go through each one of them.
Then I am not, my lord, going
to do that.
Lord, page 16, my lord.
Yeah.
My lord, my point is,
yeah,
the respectful submission is, whenever
you have raised judicial restraint, judicial
restraint. Your lordship's patience. I am sure your lordship's patience, my lord, I am fully assured of.
Yeah.
Page 16, my lord.
Yeah.
Bottom. Lord, the proposition is this. Whenever the Constitution has envisaged consultation by the President in exercise of his function or power, it has specifically provided for.
That's a good answer. Yes. That is not argued by anyone.
No, not that I am not repeating any of the submissions.
No, that's right.
Lord, please see 98.3, consultation with the head of respective legislative houses. While making rules of parliament. 124.
That's a new point. That's a new point.
Consultation with the Chief Justice of India, or as it stood originally, etc., etc. Lord, I'm not reading all.
Replicated.
Therefore, my lord, if your lordship reads any other presence or consultation, would be necessarily, Lord, in my respectful submission, rewriting the Constitution of India. Lord, now, your lordship, my lord, kindly come to page 11 only, my lord. And I just I'll make your lordship glance through it. That's all. I'll not read it. Only, my lord, allow me to read the highlighted part. Lord, page 2, Samsher Singh, yes, is the lead judgment on Article 53.
Yes.
Kindly, my lord, come to page 4, para 31. Lord, your lordship's question. How the appointments are made, but as per rules of business. That's how, my lord, it is answered. The president acts as per rules of business. So, in absence of a law, my lord, which the petitioner contend to be the law under sub-article 2, rules of business govern the field. And, my lord, that's how, my lord, the Constitution Bench in Samsher Singh has held, my lord. I'm not reading it. I assume, my lord, your lordship would definitely, my lord, read. Please read, my lord, Justice Krishna Iyer at page 6.
Yes.
Para 95, I'm not reading the entire thing.
Yes.
We are not unmindful of the agitational siege of parliamentary institutions and the anti-parliamentary buildup underway and the rashes of frustration showing up against the unsavory politics of power. But the limited task assigned to us is to interpret the Constitution as it is, not to venture starry-eyed proposals for reform. Even so, I'm reading. Even so, our activism in interpretation must not be bogged down by logomachy or blinkered by legalism, but be aglow with insightful observations of Chief Justice Marshall. Then, my lord, 138 at the foot. The president in India is not at all a glorified cipher. He represents the majesty of the state, is at the apex, though only symbolically, and has the rapport with the people and parties being above politics. His vigilant presence makes for good governance if only if he uses what Bejhot described as the right to be consulted, to warn and encourage. Indeed, Article 78, Lord, then, my lord, it is Lord, very widely, my lord. That I'm just not to compare a power of president of India to appoint constitutional functionary with an officer like CBI director. That's not the purpose. Now, your lordships, I have cited TN session. My lord, your lordships may, my lord, kindly go through.
We'll go.
Only two, my lord, paragraphs I'm tempted to say. My lord, because of the prayers made, my lord.
Yeah.
One is, my lord, State of Gujarat versus R. A. Mehta. Lord.
Lokayukta's
appointment, my lord. Where, my lord, very, very, my lord, succinctly, the Honorable Court has said, para 56.
56.
I give the citation, 2013, volume 3, SCC, page 1.
Is it part of this note?
No, it's not. Lord, therefore, Lord, I'll supply by tonight, evening today.
Kindly repeat the citation once more.
Lord, I'll give that. Lord, 2013.
You're giving a compilation.
Volume 3, SCC, page 1.
Yes.
And, my lord, there are 5 judgments. All 5, my lord, I'll give. I rely upon. With para numbers, I'll give. I'm not reading it. I'm reading only 2 paras. The principle of checks and balances is a well-established philosophy in the governance of our country under our constitution. If we were all to have our way, each person would be allowed to wage a war against every other person. This reminds us to abide by the constitutional law, followed by the statutory law, otherwise everybody would sit in appeal against the judgment of everybody. In view of the aforesaid discussion, the law as evolved and applicable herein can be summarized to the effect that the governor is bound to act on the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers unless he acts as a persona designata under a particular statute, so and so. Lord, similar are the Lord, propositions and my last submission. But what your lordships are called upon to decide or adjudicate or hold is a general sweeping law that till the law comes into force, this will be the law, which in my respectful submission, not permissible. Any outside interference would violate the theory. Last, if any appointment is made, which is the appointment of an unqualified person or otherwise undesirable person, your lordship's power of judicial review remains.
See, there is nothing like unqualified person because you have not prescribed any qualifications.
Lord,
you say that
there was a case where
you understand what you're doing.
I'm understanding.
Unfortunately, you have not put in place, like in
Pakistan. Wisely so.
Pakistan, they have put in place.
But we don't follow Pakistan mostly. That's the wise thing we do.
Look at the position they have reached. What is the neighborhood? They have said, for example, how do you define a senior bureaucrat? Somebody who has 20 years. You are following that as a convention, fine. But when you say it is a qualification, it has to be prescribed.
I'm not saying that. An unwarranted use expression, my lord, is taken up. Lord,